The Hague Initiative for International Cooperation.
Kia ora, talofalava, and welcome to this episode of the Israel Report. My name is Eric George for the Israel Institute of New Zealand, and today we are very pleased to be joined by the Honourable Alfred Ngaro. Welcome, Alfred.
Thank you.
So, as an Indigenous person, do you believe that the Jewish people of Israel have the right to self-determination?
So, first of all, the word Indigenous often relates to people of a place. Mm-hmm. If I think about for me, even though I was born here in New Zealand, mm-hmm. my parents come from the Pacific, from the Cook Islands. Mm-hmm. So I'm connected to this place, and in our Indigenous way, we say, Tako Pito, that means my afterbirth, was actually mm-hmm. put into the land. Mm-hmm. So there's a cultural and historical significance around how we connect to the land mm-hmm. For those reasons. And so for me, it's the place, it's the heritage of it, it's the culture. All of those things connect me to this place, not only here in Aotearoa, New Zealand, but also back in the Pacific as well. Mm-hmm. So I believe that we would take the same test and would ask the same question of Israel. Are Israelis, are Jewish people that are there, indigenous to the land of Israel? Mm-hmm. So the same test, are they connected to the land? Do they have a history and heritage that places them firmly as being part of that land and the people of that place? So we would say yes. In fact, it goes a long way back. And in the history of time, so there are ancient Near Eastern sort of texts and artifacts that prove that. Mm. You may have heard about the Moabite Stone, mm-hmm. which was actually discovered by a missionary, Anglican missionary, back in 1868. Mm-hmm. And it's one of those recordings that clearly state about the history and heritage of the people and of the place mm-hmm. in which the people of Israel were connected to that land and to that place as well.
Yes.
There are many artifacts that continue to tell us the history and heritage of Israel embedded in that place.
I think those really good points. Alfred, in my experience where I come and engage in wānanga and hui, you know, around across the Aotearoa and the marae, there seems to be a strong remnants of the support for Israel from the our Māori people, or tangata whenua of Aotearoa. But then on the other side of it, I always come in the university and in the educational institutes, there seems to be an entire generation of Polynesian students who have this idea that no, the Jews are just these fake Europeans. They're trying to pass off as indigenous people. They're all Europe, they're all white-eyed, blue-eyed Aryans. They have no right to the land. They took the land, they came in as conquerors. They are the new colonizers of, they have no, so where do you think this belief system came from, and how do we best battle it? How do we resist it by showing the truth and showing relevant information?
So the question really is about legitimacy. Mm-hmm. Are they the legitimate people of that land? Mm-hmm. And by the way, that question is a question that's asked throughout humanity for all peoples, in many cases. My grandmother, for instance, so her name was Rita Goldstein. Mm-hmm. Her father was Marcus Goldstein, who was a Polish Jew, mm-hmm. who in the 1880s, he escaped from over in Poland, made his way down through the Pacific, and ended up in what I would call one of the most beautiful places in the world, in the Cook Islands and in a little island called Aitutaki. Mm-hmm. Married my great-grandmother, mm-hmm. Te Piri Ariki. They had one daughter, and her name was Rita. And so when she was born, she had brownie blondie hair. She had hazily greeny eyes. So there was a point of difference to her. Mm-hmm. And even then, at that time, people asked the question, are you really who you say you are? Mm-hmm. Are you a daughter of Te Piri Ariki? And so people are always questioning people's legitimacy all the time. And so therefore, you have to give, you know, the evidence mm-hmm. To back this. And I think it's really important. So your first statement was about indigenous people, Māori people. Well, we know that when we ask that connection, they always ask about the facts that how are they connected to the land? Mm-hmm. And I believe the fact is that our Jewish people, our Israeli people, can clearly state that they're connected to the land. The reasons why, mainly through biblical texts, if you think about from Māori, mm-hmm. in which when the Christianity came into New Zealand, into Aotearoa. So there was a biblical text that gave them an ancient Near Eastern story and a narrative mm-hmm. to go back to see where the Jewish people were in Israel and Canaan at those times was connected. So for a lot of our people that are indigenous, we know that story, we know that narrative, so we can connect it that way. Mm-hmm. You then talked about in universities. Well, unfortunately, we also have in universities, and I spoke just recently at the Shalom Association of Victoria University. And when they set that up, they put out their posters of the meeting that I was going to. All of those posters were ripped down. Now, maybe it was because they had my picture on it, I don't know. But I'd like to think the fact is that what it really was the fact is that they were standing up for Israel as a nation to have the right to be there. And yet, even at Victoria University, all of their posters were torn down. And so they asked the question, you know, we have a university that's set up to be critical thinkers, to have evidence that proves the fact. When they try to have these meetings to prove the fact that actually Israel has a legitimate right to be the nation of Israel, proven many times over in history and even in our current day, and yet they were not allowed to be able to present that. And I think that's the challenge that we have before us. So in those universities, they do need to be respectful and they need to be open to hear both sides of the story. And I believe that's all the community asks for. Give us a fair opportunity to put present our case.
So, Alfred, just going off that point, to a university student that would come up to you and say, I passionately support the Jewish people as indigenous people of Israel, could you help me with some arguments or some proofs or some evidences so I can share with my friends? What are some of these arguments? What are some of these evidences?
Yeah, well, that's a good question, because I've just had four of my children, three of them have actually been through university just recently. In fact, I've got another daughter that's returning back and doing her master's. And so often what they say to me, it's about learning to be a critical thinker. How do you create the evidence? And in this case, what I would respond to them is that, for instance, it's not only historical, ancient Near Eastern evidence that can be proven. We talked about the Moabite stone. In fact, there are many evidence that show both in the country itself and in the land where Israel's history and heritage has been present. It's there as well. The other one is around genetics. So what's proven is that even when I talked about my grandmother, for instance, you know, so she's Cook Island, but she always has Jewish ancestry. There's that word called the diaspora. In other words, there are many Jewish people that are outside who are German Jewish, who are Ethiopian and Jewish. You know, there are those that have that Jewish blood and connection back to the homeland. But when they've done genetic studies, they've proven the fact is that there's still a genetic strand that links them back to into the Middle East. And so they are still genetically still connected. It'd be similar to you and I, for instance, even though you look a little bit Chinese, you know, because of your eyes, and I may look because of my nose, they feel like, well, where do you come from? But if they were to do genetics on us, and you can get actually a DNA testing, what it actually proves is the fact is that in our genetics, there's still a strand that connects us back as well. So that's part of the evidence. It's historical. There are genetics that are part of that as well. And I think that's really important. And if we think even in our current day, if we still have, I suppose, internationally, the UN Council, there's 193 countries that are represented, 163 countries in that council still acknowledge Israel as an independent national state. Now, that's pretty significant. That doesn't mean that in their council they get things wrong, because I think that they do. But when you still say today, out of the 163 still uphold Israel as its nation, as a nation of its birthplace, as the place in which both spiritually and religiously and historically that they are the rightful inheritors of that land, then that's pretty significant as well. So, Eric, I wonder if I can also ask you a question. You're a man of great intelligence and wisdom and understanding as well, and experience. So, in your mind, what response would you give to the people out there? Say, look, for instance, let's take for Indigenous Māori that are out there as well, because there are two parts of the coin. There are those that support and those that are sort of building up a momentum to say, well, actually, we should support Palestine rather than Israel. What would you say?
I think a good way to show the connection between two different Indigenous groups is to offer arguments and evidences, but to also say that as Indigenous people, the concept of Indigenous people is very, we have to define it in very clear terms. For example, in current, and I've heard this a lot in current educational institutes where they talk about Indigenous peoples and indigeneity and so forth and so on, they seem to define Indigenous peoples as non-white people. But if you look at the Sami people, who are classified under the United Nations Declaration of Indigenous Rights, the Sami people are white, blue-eyed. You couldn't distinguish them from any other sort of European ethnicity, but yet they're still designated as Indigenous peoples. So when you have to start from a point of fighting misconceptions that no, you can actually be white and have blue eyes and still be classed as an indigenous person. So indigenous person in one sense means native to the land you come from, but then when we have a redefinition of terms that no, it doesn't mean native or original to the place you come from, it means you're a victim of colonization. Well then, okay, let's apply that to the ancient Israelites. How would you define the Babylonians coming in and conquering and subduing and taking the Israelites off to slavery? How would you define the Assyrians coming in and colonizing? So either way you put it, it actually hinges upon the definition of what it means to be an indigenous person. You must destroy these misconceptions, tear down these intellectual, ideological strongholds, and in its place replace something that is based on facts, that is based on arguments, that are reasonable, that are convincing, but then more importantly, that is true. Because if they are true, then they're always relevant. And so being an indigenous person is not about being a certain skin tone. You went on about your own whakapapa. And of course, my grandfather was 5'3", blue eyes, you know, a pom from England. And so when people would see us together in the pack and save, I never realized when I was younger, but I now looking back, and I sort of felt like, he never felt, oh, you know, should they put an Amber Alert out because of these kids that look so different to my grandkids. So love is colorblind. And so the idea of purity, impurity, skin tone, it's a lot more complicated like that than that. And I think that the complexities in the arguments, the opposition, or not opposition, but those that tend to disagree with these arguments for pro-Israel, pro-Jews being the indigenous people of Israel, they tend to miss certain nuances, like the definition of what it actually means to be an indigenous person. Because what's sauce for the goose is sauce for the gander. So you can't just be consistent on the left, but then inconsistent on the right. What is evidences and arguments for one group of people can also must be applied logically and honestly and consistently to the Jewish people. And just going off from what you said about the arguments, when you do actually apply these arguments, you come out understanding, okay, they are the indigenous people of Israel.
You know, yeah, that's a really good point. In fact, just recently, I told people about my Jewish heritage. And they said, oh, we actually thought that we knew why. And I said, what was that? And they said, because of your nose, you know, because you've got this. And I think like, oh, okay, actually I did that over rugby. That's how I actually broke my nose. So, but there's a misconception, right?
Yeah.
Because they'll think about a certain people, a certain skin tone, a certain facial sort of connection, when the reality is that that heritage and that history goes way beyond that. And so it's a good response.
Do you have anything else that you would like to put forward, or something that you deeply believe that would also add another layer of recognition and objectively identifying the Jews as the indigenous people of Israel?
So in 2007, the United Nations put out a declaration for the rights of indigenous peoples. There were five sets of criteria. The one that was most significant, and I think it adds to what we're talking about today, is around continual occupation of the land. In other words, having a remnant, a presence that was there. In Māoridom and in Polynesian, there's a term called ahika, which is a sense of keeping the home fires burning. In other words, still having a sense of remnants so that in the future, that there will be an opportunity to be able to continue to define and to declare that this is still land that belongs to these people. And so when we think about that, the Jewish people, the Israeli people, have always had, historically, a continual occupation of the land. And that adds to the genetics, that adds to the historical, the artifacts that are there, to us being able to say that actually they are indigenous people of the land because of this ahika over many years, thousands of years, where they've shown that the remnant have been faithful and loyal to the nation of Israel as well. So to me, that's evidence that proves the fact.
So thank you so much, Alfred, for joining us for this episode of the Israel Report. I'm Eric George for the Israel Institute of New Zealand.
The Hague Initiative for International Cooperation.
From the Israel Institute of New Zealand.
Come from Jerusalem.